where Reddit has Tales from Tech Support, I bring you the Hakemon Tales from Tech Support. You see, for the past 9 years, I have done technical support for companies and individuals. And do I have some tales for you that are going to just knock your socks off? All right. First up, we all know the cup holder one, right? Right? The CD-ROM tray? Well, that seems to be a common thing. And you would think it's just a joke, a meme. Except no, people actually do this. So when I worked for Apple in between 2011 and 2013, I had a customer call in with the Mac Pro and said that his cup holder had broke. And I'm like, cup holder? And I had to mute my phone. And I'm like, I thought this is the kind of freaking stuff my father would tell me. Because my father told me this when he worked at Dell in the late 90s. Like, the cup holder? Nope, they really did. You put something in it, snapped off, and he's complaining. Sir, that's not a cup holder. That's a CD-ROM drive. Or DVD-ROM drive. You can put movies or CDs in there. Oh, I thought it was a cup holder. It looked like a cup holder. Why is there a hole in it for cups? No, that's for the laser to see the disc, because the laser is under the tray. Oh, well, it needs to be fixed. So you're going to have to pay for that. That's accidental damage. You mean to tell me that I have to pay for something that not my fault? It is your fault. But you didn't say it's not a cup holder. We didn't say it is. Now, granted, I was being much nicer about this, really, really trying. But yes, we didn't say it's a cup holder. It's like if you go in a car and you complain that your disco light is broken. What disco light? Oh, you were flicking your key on and off and your dashboard flickered like disco lights and now your ECU is dead in your car. Yeah, that's accidental damage. You're going to have to pay for that. Oh my god. So I have to start with that to get that one out of the way, because that's the most common one that everyone always quotes. And when I was working in IT, I never thought I would get that. Okay, moving on. So the next call I received was a customer complaining that there was an error message on their screen and that they don't know what's going on. They say it's moving around kind of fast and they can't read it. So it was an older customer and they couldn't read fast enough. So I'm trying to figure out, why is it moving around? So I'm thinking, is there a virus on this computer? And I'm like, sir, can you just give me an idea of what it says? Maybe just grab a few words? I can't. Every time I look up to it, you see, I have to get very close to the monitor. And every time I reach to it, it moves away. Interesting. Can you close out of anything on the computer? Is there any window open? Maybe like a web browser and stuff like that. What's a web browser? Never mind. Is there any X button at the top right corner of the screen? I already knew it was a PC and not a Mac. No, there's nothing on the screen. There's an error message on the screen. Well, yes, that's the only thing on the screen. Interesting. Starting to get an idea what's going on here, and I'm hoping that this isn't the case, but suspicious. And I'm like, okay, can you describe what the error looks like? Not the text, but is there any graphics? And like a shape, a color or something? Well, there's red, green, and blue boxes and stuff. And I'm like, your computer ain't on, sir. Yes, it is. The computer is on. It's lighting up and it's got the error on the screen. That's your monitor. No, that's the computer. Are you talking? Do you mean the hard drive? No, I mean the computer. You mean the computer. Like, I'm saying this in a much nicer way than I obviously am telling you right now as YouTube. But no, 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 no. It's not called a hard drive. It's called a computer. What you're calling the computer is called the monitor. Can you please turn on the computer? Okay, sir. Yes, I understand. Yes, that's the machine that we need. Can you look for a power button on that? You see, you learn not to just... You just don't argue with them. Just let them believe it. Of course, because, I mean, you could... You're damned if you do, damned if you don't. You're damned if you tell them, and then they tell you that you're wrong and that they worked in computers for long... they worked in an office long enough and know what a computer is. Hint. I've already had that discussion with someone, so that's why I use that as an example, is because that's what happened to me and why I learned not to do it. But then you're damned if you don't, because then they say, why didn't you tell me? Well, I thought you were going to yell at me. Okay, the computer's now doing stuff. Well, the stuff appearing on the screen, there's this four-colored flag appearing that says Windows XP. Yeah, your computer's turning on. But the computer was already on. I'm sorry, the hard drive. Yeah, that call went well. Because then the login screen appeared and didn't know his password. And I'm like, well, can't help you now. I was not the computer technician. I was actually the internet technician. Because, you know, some people like to call their internet provider for when there's a non-internet issue because they don't know any better. Stop popping. It's my water bottle. So, yeah, that is just how it is. You know, if you work for an internet service provider, be expected to receive calls that have nothing to do with your internet. Which brings us to the next one. We had a section of the call center dedicated, when I worked at Bright House, for the TV stuff. I did internet stuff. But I would get the occasional misdirect, but we were trained on the TV stuff, so we knew how to troubleshoot it anyway. Okay. Well, the customer is saying that the remote's not working. And I'm like, oh, that's really weird. And I'm pinging the box and the box is responding. And I'm like, does it have anything on the screen? Just out of curiosity. And he's like, yeah, it's stuck on the TV channel. But when I push the guide, nothing's happening. And I'm thinking, okay, there's a few things that this could be. Could be on a DVD player. Could be on YouTube. Could be not on the cable box at all. Or... the remote's dead. Well, to make this short, the remote batteries were indeed dead because Bright House remotes have lights on them when you press the button, and there was no light. Well, I should say they do now. They didn't always have lights on them, but I could see what kind of remote he had based on the description of the remote, and it has a light. The device selection is the light. And he says, nothing's lighting up. And I'm like, oh, that's really weird. I have seen a weird issue, though, where it can get stuck in an off mode where you have to press a device, which I have. That's happened on mine. In which case, it just doesn't do anything. You just have to press cable for some reason. So we hit cable. Try it now. Nothing. When you press cable, does cable light up? Nothing. Sir, when was the last time you changed the batteries in this? Never. I never had to change the batteries in this remote. That could be a problem. I'm looking to see when the last time a technician was even at the house. And it was for the installation, which was 5 years ago. Those batteries had lasted 5 years in that remote. And they're dead. All right, sir. Well, at this point... just go ahead and grab some new AA batteries. We can go ahead and just put it in. And as long as you put them in real fast, it won't forget your TV or anything. Sir, I should not have to buy batteries for my cable remote. It is your cable remote, therefore your batteries. That's not how this works. You are responsible for the consumables, aka the batteries. once again, I'm saying these things so much nicer, but I don't work in this industry anymore, so I'm not going to say this nice anymore. Okay, I'll try to explain how I said it. Oh, I understand the frustration, sir. Trust me, I have so many remotes and so many batteries. I go through, you know, I understand. Unfortunately, Bright House Networks does not cover those batteries because they are batteries. Just like when you buy a car, you have to replace the battery when that fails, or your TV remote when that remote battery fails, you have to replace that. Kind of realizing that the car analogy was kind of a crappy one, because you're not renting a car. I mean, if you rent a car, they'll replace the battery, but, you know, it is what it is. No, the customer decided to retaliate and say he's going to come over to our office and blow us up. Boy, did that escalate quickly. All of a sudden, we went from angry for remote controls to murder. I'm going to go ahead and put you on hold while I transfer you to my supervisor. Because at that point, we're not supposed to touch that call. Hold. Call the supervisor up. Let them know what's going on. Bright House at the time had what's called PRT. That's what we called supervisors, but they're not really supervisors. They're fake supervisors, but they actually can pull a lot of strings, more than the supervisors actually can. So that's why I would call them supervisors. It was easier for the customer because they could do more than real supervisors anyway. All a real supervisor can do, take compliments. That's it. And they won't even take the call. They'll let it just go to voicemail because they're lazy. That was Bright House. Yeah, anyway. Call up the PRT and they're like, oh boy, this sounds like this is going to be a rough one. And I was like, yeah, he's very angry and oh, he apparently knows where we are thanks to Google, so he actually set our address. Oh, great. Police are going to have to be called now. Lockdown. Thanks, Mr. Remote Control Battery Guy. You put us on lockdown because you were being dumb. I wish that was it, but it's not. So now when I worked at Apple, we've had, you know, customers call in with all sorts of legitimate issues, and I've tracked down stuff in iLog as to what's going on. And oh boy, I would get quite a few iMac customers that don't know what to do when they plug it in. And I don't know if it's because this is one of the few Macs that don't have a power button on the front, or easily viewable. The Mac Minis seem to be less of an issue for some reason, but the iMac, oh, they couldn't find it. So they'd plug it in, they'd call it up saying, my computer's not working. Well, what's it doing? It's black screen. Have you tried turning it on? Well, I plugged it in. Have you pressed the power button? There's no power button. Yeah, there is. No, there's not. Meditate. This is where I would need my meditation time at work. Okay. Reach up behind the monitor and feel around. You're going to feel a little divot. Because, you know, they can't turn it around because they pushed it in all the way in their desk and now the cords are like super tight. If they pull it forward, all the cables are coming out. So you can't turn it because they got the 27-inch model either, so it can't really pivot on the desk. Oh, I feel a little pimple. Go ahead and press that. And then you hear in the background the Mac bong sound, and I'm like, yes. And he's like, oh, why isn't that in the manual? Now, you see, people, this was a time when Apple was not including quick start guides or manuals at all with their computer. It was on the hard drive in a PDF form, so you had to get the computer on to actually look at how to hook it up. They weren't including it with the computer. And you know, sir, that's a really good question. I honestly will forward this up to the department that'll handle this. I can't. No, that's a lie. I can't. They're not going to listen. Paper-free. Energy efficient. Yeah, to the point where customers don't know how to turn on the damn computers. That was a fairly easy one, and it was less frustrating, but it's really frustrating when they argue and say that there is no power button, and they're very sure of it, when of course there is. Let's see, what's another one? I'm trying to think. Oh, boy. Now, there are my share of sad cases when I worked at Apple. Because I was actually dual trained. I did iOS and macOS. Well, I would get calls from iPhone customers that set up a password, forgot their password. Now they can't unlock it. They never backed up their device. And now they are going to lose all their family photos. Well, you see, when you put a password on it, the device becomes encrypted. So breaking that encryption is going to be a very challenging problem. So getting those pictures back are pretty impossible. Ooh, yeah, you kind of put yourself in a pickle there now, didn't you? I feel bad, actually, for those calls because my mother's own iPhone put a password. Actually, she didn't even have a password on her phone. Her phone just magically put a password on itself and then... Well, it had iCloud backups all the way to 2017. It's missing 2 years worth of data, but we were able to figure it out. So, that worked. Anyway, moving forward, always keep a backup, please, people. I actually keep claiming this on my Facebook page for family and friends. Mostly family. My friends all know how to do backups. My family, not so much. And I keep saying it. Please, do backups. Consult your manual. Do backups. And at this point, I hate to say it, and I'm not trying to be mean or anything. It's just, if I do technical support, I'm going to charge you for it. That's my line of business. I didn't go to school and get all these certifications for nothing. God, this thing is going to fall on me now. These silly Logitech webcams don't like to stay in place very well. Anyway, yeah, I didn't go to all this trouble just to give out free technical support. It's why on YouTube, when someone asks me a silly question, like on the video about enabling VTX on CPUs that don't have the BIOS support, and you're asking me how to reset your BIOS password, call them. Namely one, because it probably can't actually be done because laptops are very different than desktop PCs, and two, every manufacturer is different, and I'm not about to waste my time trying to figure it out and explain it to you because it's going to go back and forth and I should be charging you for my time. Sorry, people. I know it comes off as an asshole for me, but my time is worth money. And if you think you can just come to me for free technical support for these really advanced issues, no. If it's a very simple issue, I'll probably make a video about it. Or if it is a complicated issue, but it's something that a lot of people can benefit from, I'll make a video about it. But a laptop BIOS password is not a simple process. That is actually a much more involved process than people may realize. And no, you're going to pay me for that. All right. Back to Tales from Tech Support with Hakemon. Alright, so obviously I've had my share of very interesting calls, and you know, of course, it's very concerning just how much you go through as a technician. Stress. So I used to have a micro speed trackball, which is kind of based off the CST trackball that I actually use right now. And that trackball, it actually couldn't be used on any modern computer. It was a bus interface, if anyone remembers those. So I actually took the ball out of it and was using it as a stress ball at work. I'd roll it around my hand just to try to keep me calm, and it actually worked really well. And I had to for the call I'm about to tell you now. So when you get a call and the customer says that they have no internet access, you can't just take that as that the internet's not working. No. Don't make the mistake I made. You see, they may not be talking about the internet itself. Could be the computer, like the person with the computer that wasn't on. Or it could be that they hid their browser icon somehow, and now that's their idea of saying the internet's out, because the icon is gone. Yeah. So I would ask them, well, what web browser do you normally use? Don't ask that question. If you work in IT, don't ask that question. You don't want to hear the answer. What's a web browser? Roll the ball. Roll the ball. Play with the ball. Well, the web browser is the icon you normally click when you are ready to go on the internet. I don't understand. I just turn it on and it comes up. What? So, wait a minute. So when you log into your computer, what do? Well, I click on the E. That's your web browser. That's Internet Explorer. So do you see that E anywhere? No, that's the problem. The internet is out. Okay, see, what you're telling me is that the internet is out. You see, we have to rephrase these questions, not because customers think we sound stupid when we're talking like this, but we're actually trying to really clarify that this is what the issue is, because you're not telling us in plain English. Your idea of plain English, simply put, is not good English. Okay, I made a mistake by doing that. Okay, that's better. Okay. I understand. The E is gone. We need to get the E back. Can you go ahead and click on the start button for me? Well, what's the start button? Now, mind you, this was Windows XP was still the primary OS. Vista was still kind of newish at this time. So, people at this point generally had a button that said start on it. So I'm thinking at this point, maybe they're using Vista. Okay, so at the very bottom left corner of your screen, bottom left, what is there? Oh, it's a button that says start. That's a start button. Can you click on that? Well, I've never had to do that before. No, but we're troubleshooting this now. Because I'm thinking I'm going to try to get this icon back. Boy. This brings up really bad memories. Like, I'm not even kidding you. So now on Windows XP, this was the method we did. I'm trying to remember if this is actually how I did it. So when we clicked on start, at the very top, it was like, oh, there's the E. I can go ahead and just click that. And I'm like, wait. Do you want it on your desktop? Well, there it is. It's on my desktop. No, it's in the start menu. Are you going to remember to click start every time? What's the difference? Roll the ball. I drop the ball. Pick up the ball. Now I'm really mad. Okay, well, the difference is instead of just clicking on the E when you turn on the computer, you would have to click the start button. Well, I never had to do that before. I don't know why you guys can't just fix this. That's what I'm trying to do. It's not a problem with our service. It's a problem with your computer. But I am going to help you, even though it's beyond our scope of support. I will help you with this. What I need you to do is hover your mouse cursor over that E, right click, and there should be an option to send to. Do you see that? I see open, run as, open with. You don't have to read it all. Just look for send to. Okay, send to. Okay, now do you see desktop create shortcut? I do. Click that. Oh, everything just went away. That's okay. The menu will close. Do you see the E on your desktop now? Yeah, but now it says shortcut to Internet Explorer. It used to just say Internet Explorer. Now realizing that they knew what the icon actually was called that they were clicking on, but they had to tell me it was the E. That's okay. It doesn't matter, as I'm not going to try to explain how to just rename it, because at this point, this is becoming a complicated process, and I'm not supposed to be helping you with this. Well, that's okay, sir. It looks like it's working now. It may say something a little different. That's okay, but when you double-click it, it will go to the same thing. Okay, well, can I just try it real quick? Sure, go right ahead. Just double-click on it. Okay, it's working. Awesome. And then I have to ask, is there anything else I can help you with today? No, that'll be it. All right, you have a good one. Roll the ball, roll the ball. Smack the ball on my head, roll the ball. No, I didn't hurt myself. I wanted to a couple times. Some calls like this, it makes me just want to smack myself. Or head desk, head desk, head desk. Yeah, so people are a pain in the butt. And I get it. Some people are just not born knowing how to use computers. But I don't think it should be that much of a challenge to try to learn the computer. There are computer classes, and I think some people should take these classes because some people just don't get it. And I don't think you should be using technology that you're unfamiliar with. You should learn the technology that you want to use. You wouldn't just get in a car and start, never mind, some people do it. Yeah, that was a bad analogy because some people do just start driving a car without having any actual training in how to drive a car. Yeah, idiots. So yeah, another tale from tech support. What can I think of here? Ah, yes. The person who wanted me to perform magic voodoo. I'm not even kidding. Calls up, says the internet's not working. That's all I hear. The internet's not working. Internet's not working. Yeah, what can I help you today? The internet's not working. Yeah, that's what the last person said. So in this case, I see that the modem's online. I mean, it's working. Now, granted, that doesn't mean it is actually working. It's just responding to the head end. But, you know, CMTS side versus actual customer side can be a different story. Sometimes the router could have failed. Modems are layer 2 devices, and sometimes that can somehow fail. The physical side's up, but the layer 2 side is not. So, well, okay, can you go ahead and tell me what the modem is doing? Well, where's the modem? I don't know. Probably near your computer? Oh, I don't know. I have like a pile of clothes everywhere. Oh, boy. Is it under clothes and overheating? Well, sir, I need you to find the modem. When they set it up, were you there when they set it up? No, I was making a sandwich. Funny you remember that specific detail, but you don't know where they put the modem. Because you weren't paying attention to a strange person in your house. You were just letting them do their thing, and well, you know, now you have a modem, you don't even know where it is. But the customer asks me to come over right now to help him find the modem. I tell him I can't do that, but we can schedule a technician to come out if we can't locate this modem. No, I need you to come over right now. I can't do that right now. It's like 11 o'clock at night. I really can't. All the technicians have gone home that actually could go to a house. And the guys finally said, no, you don't get it. I want you to come through the phone and come here. What? You want me to what now? You want me to just magically come through the phone? Yes. I'm hoping the person was just high on something, and this wasn't actually how his thought process worked. Because unfortunately, that seems to be a common thing, is some of these people really just don't know what they're doing. Or they want you to perform a miracle, a magic miracle, as I call it, a magic miracle. So yeah, that was that call, and I at that point was just kind of getting a little frustrated, and I'm like, all I can do is schedule a technician if you do not know where your modem is. Can't you just echo locate it? Call's not over yet, boys and girls. No, we can't actually see in your home where the modem is. And we can't echo locate it because the electricity on the wire travels at the speed of sound. I mean, the speed of light, not the speed of sound. So I can't quite echo locate the modem. Actually, there is some interesting, cool technology that can do some kind of stuff like that, but not what's in the house. That'll be a YouTube video for another day on how network technicians can tell you where a break in a cable is down to the footage, down wire. It's kind of cool technology. But at the time, I didn't really know what it was, that even existed anyway, but the modem doesn't have it anyway. That's specialized equipment. No, sir, we can't do that. Oh, well, is it possible I don't have a modem? No, I'm showing you have a modem. Well, you see, it was working earlier today, and I had a friend over, and when he left it, the internet wasn't working anymore. Starting to get curious. The modem's online. Interesting. Okay. I see he has TV service as well. Is the TV working? Yeah, the TV's working just fine. But your internet's not. You don't know where the modem is. You want me to perform some magic miracles. But now I'm starting to wonder. It went out when your friend left. Sir, can you give me a few minutes? I want to take a look at something here real quick. Okay. Mute or hold. So we actually have music to listen to versus silence, dead air. So I now know that he has cable TV and cable internet. Now they should be connecting to the same head end. They're not. I then realized that his friends stole the modem and must have brought it to his house, which had TV but no internet, and connected it into his house. He stole the modem. Sir, we are definitely going to need to send a technician over here, but I'm going to need to escalate this to my supervisor because I feel that something may have happened to that modem. Since you don't know where it is, I'm noticing that the modem is not connected to where it normally is connected to as far as streetwise. And the customer starts picking up on it. Do you think my friend might have stolen the modem? That I don't know. No, I was like this. That I don't know, but we need to check into this. At this point, I think it's kind of obvious that the friend took it, but we can't do that. We can't say that. We need to investigate this. And then they'll send a technician, supervisors. We'll contact this friend and they'll find out where he lives. Especially since he had the same service, we can go in the house to figure out what's going on here. I mean, well, you can't just show up. Well, I mean, you can, but they can choose not to let you in. But if they find that modem is on your line, they can choose to shut off your services and you're in big doo-doo. So basically, long story short, the friend did actually steal the modem. The modem was recovered and brought back to the customer without coming through the telephone line itself, because that's just not physically possible. Yeah, that's about all I have for right now. I'm going to leave you with that, because working in tech support, I have a lot of stories I could tell you, but these were the best ones that I had for now, at least that I could remember. I might remember some more later. Oh! A good one. I'll leave you with the best one for last. Oh, I forgot. And I actually remembered this one to keep it for last. So this is actually perfect timing. When I was working for the county doing network administration, I would also service computers and printers as required. Printers were a pain in my butt, but we did them. I got a ticket in case. We used Dell Case. Sucks. But that's what we used. The ticket said... Oh boy, maybe I have a picture of this. I might not actually have a picture of this. I was kind of hoping that I would. Yeah, it looks like, unfortunately, I don't have a picture of this. Darn. Anyway, had a ticket come in, and it said, lizard stuck in printer. Okay. I look up to see what printer it is, because they luckily gave me which building it is, what room it is, and I can see that there's only one printer in there, and it's a laser printer. Oh boy, this is going to be disastrous if they use it. I get there to look at this lizard printer with another printer, because I'm not going to try to, just in case I can't get the lizard out, I got a replacement printer for you. And they said, well, you see, since we put in that ticket, now our printings have this streak on it. It was lizard guts. Even with the lizard in the printer, they decided it would be okay to continue to use the printer. And the lizard, well, look up how laser printers work and look to see what this really went wrong. And you'll know why their next complaint was, the room smells bad now. Oh, yep, lizard stuck in printer. I really wish I could have sworn I had a picture of that. Maybe it's in one of my backups somewhere. Let me look real quick. I have some backups from when I worked at the county and some of those photos, and I might. Slim possibility, but it's entirely possible that I do still have those. Not in that one. Camera roll. Nope, not in that. No, but I just accidentally found photos that are like 10 plus years old. Including when my car was white. Anyway, YouTube, that's all I really got. If I ever find those photos, I will happily share the ticket. Because I swear to you, I have a photo somewhere of that ticket. Because I kept it. Because I didn't want to lose that one. Because that one was just ridiculous. Have a good one, YouTube.